high deserve mark. It's a good ball in. Stephen causes confusion. Great touch by Glenn, and whack, it goes in. They really do deserve this. They've battled through, they've toughed it out, and they're back in with a chance again. Come on, the Crews.
Well, it's really about the first time in the game that Glenn Hunter has been afforded any space at all in the penalty area or around the edge of it. And I think we said earlier in the game that he was a fairly tricky player and he could turn in a sixpence, and he certainly proved it there. Burrows in for Livingston. Different Crusaders side now. Dunn. And they stayed onside, have they? No, the flag's up. And that must have been a marginal decision. And a free kick to Silkeborg. But it's 2-1 now. An early goal from Fernandez. And then Larson with a penalty. And the announcement over the PA that Hunter has scored. And that'll bring some relief and a lot of joy to Roy Walker there.
But as long as they keep the discipline, teams are always most vulnerable directly after they've scored, Mark. And that's a great lift for everybody here. But as long as they keep their shape, keep their discipline and keep playing.
Dunlop away. Kurt Hunter. Now here's Glenn Dunlop. He's full of confidence now. And I know whenever he was at Linfield, David, that he felt he was underused. His confidence had gone, and then Crusaders brought him back again. And what a move that was for him.
It so often can be the way, Mark. You know, not everybody succeeds at Linfield. And maybe he wasn't given the opportunity that he deserved. But here he's come back to Crusaders and has done extremely well.
And now here's Burrows! Well, if Glenn Hunter can score spectacular goals, Sid Burrows can do better, and he almost did there with a fabulous piece of football. And it was Glenn Hunter who set it up with that most precise and accurate of headers. And what a goal that would have been.
Good
well,
touch.
Suddenly, Crusaders are a much different outfit.
Yes, you know, it was a great flick on by Glenn, and Sid was unfortunate to keep the ball down.
Up goes Callaghan, Vordergaard, Sorensen, and Risa, but Dunlop recovers. And now it's Kirk Hunter. Ball is pretty difficult to control. That was a lovely touch from Liam Dunn to Sid Burrows, who's full of running again. And now here's Tyson again. Crusaders must guard against giving the ball away, because we have seen how swiftly Silkeborg can move forward. And as Brian Clough says, it only takes a second to score a goal. And certainly with Silkeborg's first, we saw exactly what he meant. Glenn Hunter. And a free kick against Tyson. Crusaders goal scorer, Glenn Hunter. A lovely touch again from under. Here's Baxter. One player in the penalty area was Glenn Hunter, and now it's a corner kick to Crusaders. Well, what a comeback this would be if the Crews could level things here. And plenty of voice now from the crowd. It's Sid Burrows with the corner. Baxter near post. Too close to the goalkeeper, though. He had time to catch that, but maybe he's feeling the pressure as well. And that's Larson who gets it away.
If he did, if Crusaders could keep getting the ball into the box, the goalkeeper does not look comfortable. Balls coming in when players are putting him under pressure.
He looks a bit shaky. Here's Baxter. Sorensen snapping at the heels. And it's another corner. Well played, Stephen Baxter. Crusaders keeping the pressure on. They certainly haven't allowed the Danish side to get back into their rhythm after the Crusaders' goal. That's a poor corner, and Kasper clears it away. McMullen, still six or seven Crusaders players in the penalty area. Oh, well, that could have run for Callaghan and Livingston there. Again, poor defence from Silkeborg. They had a chance to get it away. They didn't take it. Now Dunlop plays it back in towards Livingstone. Good header. Hunter comes in. Larson clears. Now here's Reese. He's on his own at the moment. Oh, what a good ball that is for Peterson. Peterson and Dunn. Peterson going well here. And the tackle from Glendon Lough was a very good one. And now Livingston could do with thumping it forward because there were plenty of Crusaders players in attacking positions. Dunn, but he can't get it away. Now it's Brune. And now here's Reese. Crusaders could be caught here. Reese! Good save, McKeown. And I think Reese did the right thing because he saw McKeown moving away from his near post there. And he just took a little step here. And he was looking for that yard in the corner, but well covered by Kevin McKeown indeed. Baxter. And that's a very good header into the path of Sid Burrows. Early cross required. Glenn Hunter near post, far post, nobody. Deuce. Reese. Oh, what a great ball from Deuce that is. And offside this time. It was Bordergaard who played the ball through for Peterson, but reminiscent of the first goal they scored, David. They are lightning on the break.
Very much so, Mark. But there was Gary McCartney showing all of his experience. 15 took off, but Gary just stepped off and caught him offside. Good bit of defending by Gary McCartney.
Dunlop. That's Baxter with a very well-directed header to Livingston. Now here's McMullen. Battling hard for the ball. That's Callaghan to Dunn. Oh, well played by young Liam Dunn, who played for the Irish League representative side. A very fine young player indeed. Baxter gets it back to Dunn. Kirk Hunter's in the penalty area. He'll go for everything. And it's Hunter! So close he was to getting a goal in the first half. And he's just the man you want in those situations. And he headed it down, which was important.
It was important as well, Mark, but as the ball came in, if Glenn Hunter hadn't gotten his way, Kirk would have had a freer header, and I think we could have even had a goal there. Great crossing from Liam Dunn, particularly as Sorensen actually went to hurt him in that last tackle.
15 minutes to go. 2-1 for Silkeborg. And we've witnessed in this match one of the best goals ever scored, probably, by an Irish League player in Europe. Tremendous goal it was, too, by Glenn Hunter. Callaghan, good football from him. And he's onside Stephen Livingston here. And he's got Glenn Hunter in the penalty area and Stephen Baxter. And in comes Sid Burrows now, and here's Baxter! Again, Baxter, a second chance. Carr behind it, but what a display this has been in the second half from Crusaders. Full of heart, and they deserve everything they get.
To be honest with you, Mark, I think we're running out of superlatives here. Great flick by Sid. Stephen, one shot, blocked, another shot, and that was so unfortunate to go in. This is absolutely tremendous by Crusaders.
Evokes a chuckle from the crowd, but not in a dangerous situation. Here's Burrows again. And great stuff from Burrows, who's really buzzing now. Glenn Hunter near post. And that's Morten Brune, the very experienced Danish international, who was the covering player.
Interesting to note, Mark, one or two of the Silkeborg players have got their socks down round from their knees. I wonder if they're beginning to tire.
Well, certainly they've lacked a little bit of discipline in the last 20 minutes or so. Passes in the first half were going to feet, are now being hacked aimlessly into the sky here at the Shore Road in Belfast. And that's Peder Knudsen, second substitute. Crusaders still have the 11 on the field they started with. Dunn, oh, good work from him. Here's Kirk Hunter and Glenn Hunter. Was another marginal decision there. I think it might become a little bit clearer in a moment or two. Let's see if we can judge from here. Just at the point when Hunter hits it, it's going to be difficult to tell from that angle, but well, it probably was pretty close there, that decision. Now Knudsen gets it to Sorensen. Now Castberg comes in, and that's a good ball to Bordergaard. Reese did well to keep it down, but not with enough power direction to worry the Scottish goalkeeper. for Crusaders, Kevin McGill. Here's Hunter. Glenn Hunter. Free kick to Crusaders. We can expect a storming final 10 minutes here from the Crews. Four Crusaders players in the penalty area. Kirk Hunter, who's had a couple of notable headers in this game, is in the box once again. And this time it's Larson who gets it away to Bordergaard. Trevor McMullen, Stephen Baxter in the box with Glenn Hunter. In it goes towards Baxter. A bit of room for him. Here's Burrows. And a wee bit weak from Sid Burrows, but again, Crusaders are causing a lot of problems, and Stephen Baxter is a one-man irritant at the moment to this Silkeborg defence. Castberg, and that's a good ball for Peterson. Border guards at the far post, Knudsen in there too. Now here's Brun. Two Danes in the penalty box. And the Danes quite happy to eat a few seconds away. Of course, a 2-1 win for them would be a fine result for the Danish team.
Being very professional, Mark, they're just hitting it long, hitting it into corners, and just holding the ball up and just trying to slow everything down.
Now it's Risa, long throw expert. Sorensen in the six-yard box again. Oh, and problems here in the six-yard box, and it's Sorensen. He tried to shape the ball into the corner there. Here's Deuce. He's pretty pacey, I have to say, but it's going to be a goal kick to Crusaders. A bit of huffling and kerfuffling in the penalty area there, and Sorensen just trying to curl it round the outside of McKeown, but Livingston is in front of it. Pass off. Cheers, Glenn Hunter. Now Burrows again. Three players in the penalty area. Needs to get it in. Good looking cross it is. Livingston, well played, the goalkeeper. At last he does something positively, and with an air of confidence. He hasn't been like that for most of the rest of the match. Not a bad cross it was either, but well claimed. And Kirk Hunter is going off. He's going to get a great reception for his display. And number 14, Chris Morgan, who's had a very good pre-season, scoring a few goals, the 19-year-old, who scored against Reading. And he's 3 minutes to make an impact here. Risa. And a bit of pushing and shoving, and a free kick to the Crews.
Lovely moment there for Kirk Hunter, maligned by many, but tonight he epitomised everything good about Irish League football, and he has done himself credit.
Now Risa, and oh, he's onside here. Peter, oh, well, the flag's up now. Heart-stopping moments for the Crusaders' defence, and for a second it looks as if the flag was going to stay down. Beauregard, and a good header by Glenn Dunlop to get in front of Peterson. Beauregard, and that was a good cross again. The time it was Liam Dunn of all people who got the ball away, the shortest man on the pitch perhaps. Here's Stephen Baxter, Hunter to his right. Good clearance by Larson. But Crusaders breaking in European style there, David, and a good move from them.
Very, very quick breakout. Do you know, Mark, we have this perennial debate in Irish League football about whether our club should be in Europe. And this display by Crusaders tonight has silenced all of those who think we shouldn't be there.
Absolutely. Couldn't agree more. Can't be long to go. I mean, they could have crumbled it 2-0 down, but my goodness, they have fought hard. And they've certainly been the better side in the last 25 minutes of this second half. There's no doubt about that. That's Burrows. And here's Baxter. And I'm dubious about this tag the goalkeeper has of being second only to Peter Schmeichel, but the whistle is gone. It's all over here at Seaview, and Silkeborg have won on the night by 2-1. But the hero has to be Glenn Hunter. 27 years ago, John McCullen scored a goal for Crusaders against Cambra Turner. He's bridged that gap. Over 800 minutes of European football have passed. Crusaders hadn't scored until that man popped up and drilled the most exquisite of shots past the goalkeeper here. The fans certainly appreciating that second-half performance, David. Excellent.
Mark, the Crusaders' team spirit is near legendary in Irish League football. They gave their all. At 2-0 down, they were dead and buried, but they fought back. They went and they went again. They fought to a man. Roy Walker must be so very proud. They've done themselves proud, supporters club, but they have done Irish League football proud. Fantastic performance. Well done, Crusaders.
But it'll be tough in the away leg. The final score here at Seaview is Crusaders 1 and Silkeborg 2.
Glenn, a defeat for Crusaders, but it must have been quite a satisfying night for you yourself.
Absolutely, it was the first goal of the season, and it was very nice to get my first European goal too.
And you seem to have so much time to put it away.
It didn't seem that much. I'll watch it again tonight, but it just hit it first time, and when it hit the back end, I was very happy.
We are very happy now because we expected a very intense game with a lot of problems. We had a lot of problems, but we managed to score 2 goals away. That's very important for us.
Were Crusaders as good a side as you expected them to be?
Yeah, I must say we expected a very tough team, good runners, and that's just what we saw here tonight. I like the team. I like Crusaders.
Well, you have to be optimistic. You could say a whole lot and you could end up with egg in your face, but I think I learned tonight that when we had the ball and when we pressed hard onto them, there were a few gaps in behind them. And, you know, if you throw enough rice at the barn door, you're sure to hit it a few times, so that's got to be the attitude.
And a lot of people will forget that this was your first competitive game of the season.
First competitive game, not a bad match to begin with, so let's hope it goes up from here.
Well, of all the Irish League sides involved in Europe, Glenavon looked to be the best bet to progress to the first. When Windsor Park will be bulging at the seams for Linfield's friendly game against the mighty Liverpool. And we'll have the best of the action here on BBC One at 10:30 on Monday evening. But for now, from all of us here at Seaview, good night.
Wogan's Island at the movies.
Glenavon will be up against it in their away legs of their preliminary round UEFA Cup matches. Glenavon could only draw 0-0 with Hafnarfjordur last night, while Crusaders put up a gutsy performance and scored an outstanding goal, but eventually went down 2-1 to Danish side Silkeborg. The highlights from Seaview are described by Mark Robson.
Bordegaard just keeps it in, and that's a good cross. Fernandez! Goal to Silkeborg. And Bordegaard did brilliantly to keep the ball in play. And a good finish by Fernandez. Here comes Lauerson for Silkeborg. In goes Morten Brun. Brun, Callaghan trips him, and it's a penalty. Michael Larsson, 2 steps, and 2-0. A very well-taken penalty by Michael Larsson. Sid Burrows, Aaron Callaghan at the near post. And in there goes Hunter, now Livingstone! Aaron Callaghan! It's going to be difficult to see from this angle whether it actually crossed the line, but what a great opportunity that was for Crusaders. Well, you just can't tell there from Larsson. Callaghan gets it back to McMullen, tries to turn Tyson. Callaghan, edge of the box is Baxter. In there goes Hunter! Oh, what a goal! Glenn Hunter! A real touch of class! And that was a fabulous goal. And just what Crusaders needed. Well, just watch this for a turn by Glenn Hunter. And now here's Burrows. Well, if Glenn Hunter can score spectacular goals, Sid Burrows can do better, and he almost did there.
2 weeks' time in Denmark. Can you snatch a result?
Well, of course, it's always possible. It's highly unlikely. But then again, you know, when people write us off, you never know what can happen. You know, you have to be optimistic. You could say a whole lot and you could end up with egg in your face. But I think I learned tonight that when we had the ball and when we pressed hard onto them, there were a few gaps in behind them. And, you know, if you throw enough rice at the barn door, you're sure to hit it a few times. So that's got to be the attitude.
Action at home last night. It wasn't a great evening for either, with Glenavon surely ruining the failure to take a lead over FH of Iceland. Champions Crusaders are still in the frame, despite that 2-1 defeat by Silkeborg. An outstanding goal, though, lifted the roof at Seaview.
Crusaders started slowly last night as Silkeborg went one up after just 15 minutes. Vordingborg's cross finished by Fernandes. The home team hoped for a good start to the second half, but when Bruin stretched the defence, Aaron Callaghan conceded the penalty. Taking the shortest of run-ups, Larsson made it 2-0. This was the cue for a Crusaders fight-back. Showing great skill and control, Glenn Hunter controlled Callaghan's cross and volleyed to the net with great style. Crusaders then pushed on for the equaliser, but without any luck, as this effort by Sid Burrows went just over the top.
Well, I'm proud of all the players. I think in the second half, the play was predominantly down this end of the pitch and they were defending. And with a bit of luck around the box, we would have got a result out of it, you know, which I felt over on the night our play deserved. I'm disappointed at the two goals we gave away, but they were very, you know, certainly preventable. But outside of that, I mean, we did ourselves proud.
Well, as the manager said, we showed them a lot of respect in the first half an hour of the game, and we thought we should have took it to them. We let their defence come out at us, and then we just said, well, we'll have a go at them. And it was a tough encounter.
...4-3 win over Glentoran. Meanwhile, today's League Cup draw set up the cruise with Cliftonville, Carrick against Oma, Portadown at home to Linfield.
...the Cup roundup. Crusaders have unhappy memories of Glentoran striker Trevor Smith. At the end of last season, his penalty sealed a Premier Division place for the Glens. And Kevin McKeown will be sick of the sight of his fellow countrymen too after this rare slip. 1-0 to Glentoran, but backstormed the Crews through the aerial route. The tallest man in the league, Stephen Baxter, made it one each. The weight of Stephen Livingstone's flowing locks means he can't jump quite as high as Baxter. But a header from the deck at the far post, and it was 2-1. And the league champions were 3-1 ahead at the start of the second half. Declan Devine beaten again, this time by Glenn Hunter. A quite magnificent effort. But the Glens have their own talented Glenn as well, Glenn Little, and he kick-started the revival. 3-2. Glentoran coach Billy Sinclair was sent off from the dugout by referee Norman Cowie for verbal abuse. But the Glens didn't let that grind them down, and Big Little levelled the game at 3 apiece, his shot taking a deflection past McKeown. Glentoran beat the Crews 4-2 in the corresponding game last season, but Crusaders got their revenge this time, Glenn Hunter scoring the winner.
I thought we showed a degree of hunger that's been missing in the previous two games. You know, that was sort of us getting back to something like we can do. Hungry to win the
game's match against Silkeborg in Denmark. Goalkeeper Kevin McKeown has been past fit, but Sid Burrows is extremely doubtful. And the Crews are 2-1 down after the first leg at Seaview. European trips aren't often happy ones for Irish League clubs. 2 years ago in Servette, the Crews lost 4-0. But their attitude hasn't changed, and they'll take the game to the Danes.
You have to hold when you haven't got the ball, but when you have the ball, you have to look to do things with it, because opportunities in Europe are few and far between. or at least that's always been the way. But, you know, if a second half performance here is anything to go by, well, you know, that should at least give us hope. And, you know, no one's infallible, and you know, they have two arms and two legs just like we have, and it's a matter of us getting enough possession to play in the last third of the pitch, and maybe create something.
Glenn Hunter, who scored the winner against the Glens on Saturday and who struck against Silkeborg at Seaview, didn't travel. A big loss for Roy Walker, who knows his favourite catchphrase of Crusaders' commitment won't just be enough.
Well, you're playing in games where there's great atmosphere and there's passion, and as well as that, you know, you're representatives of your country, and that's got to stir people on. You know, so we want to show that, you know, Irish League football is at a high level. And certainly we can do that with commitment, but I feel that if we get enough of the ball, we can do it with a fair degree of skill. And let's hope that, you know, the plaudits on the evening are for a team that went over and had a go and didn't lie down.
At the European Nations Cup... ...in the second leg of their UEFA Cup preliminary round tie, an aggregate of 6-1. Crusaders 2-1 down after the home leg had the first scoring opportunity. Trevor McMullen rattled the bar. But when Jim Gardner lost possession at the edge of the box, the Danes demonstrated their supreme counter-attacking skills. A similar move which led to their penalty at Seaview. The Crew's defence split wide open and it was 1-0 on the night. Sid Burrows, who wasn't expected to start the game, created most of the Crew's attacking opportunities here for Stephen Baxter to head over. Silkeborg made it 2-0, again on a quick counter, and it was Jaime Fernandez, scorer at Seaview, who turned Gary McCartney and blasted past McKeown. The Crew's keeper was at fault for the third, misjudging a corner, and Kenny Sommer could hardly miss. McKeown hasn't been at his best recently due to an Achilles injury, though he was thoroughly unlucky with the Danes' fourth, Sommer barging past Livingstone and Callaghan. It was the Danes' night all right, deflections and all. Striker Glenn Hunter, who scored in the first leg, missed tonight's game, but called into UTV to give his reaction. Well, Glenn, you've seen the highlights of tonight's game. What did you make of what you saw?
I was a bit disappointed with the result, but it looks like the fellas have went out and gave their best. I hadn't anything to lose, really.
There seemed to be a few holes opening up at the back of the Crusaders' defence tonight.
That's right. The Saltboard team, they were very fast on the break. They seemed to create a lot of space for themselves, which gave them that wee bit extra time. But it looks like the fellas have really put...
Trevor McMullen rattled the bar. But when Jim Gardner lost possession at the end...
Down on the half hour. Liam Dunn's cross. Stephen Baxter's looping header. A minute after the break, Sid Burrows' free caused consternation. But Aaron Callaghan was alert enough to steer in the second. Celebrations, Clinsman-like. Minutes later, the lively Burrows was the instigator again, and his cross was clipped home by Glenn Hunter, his 100th for the club. And the league champions completed the rout in the closing minutes. Hugh Sinclair handled.
Bill and Crusaders had a glut of goal-scoring opportunities. And 5 minutes before the end of extra time, Ian Hill hit the bar for the Reds. But it just wasn't their night. In fact, it never is in a penalty shootout. Cliftonville missed the first two, and the Crew scored their first three. And when Gary Sliney missed a third, Crusaders were through. Cliftonville's 17th successive loss in a shootout. Well, finally, in the boys... ...by 3-1 at the Oval. And the Crews will now play the winners of tomorrow night's other semi-final between Glenavon and Portadown. Lawler to McKeown. Straight to John Quigg. Burrows nips in to steal it from him. Now Glenn Dunlop. Glenn Dunlop looking around him. Awareness finds Burrows. Forward ball for Glenn Hunter, who's onside. Here's Hunter. Inside, and it's 1-0 for Crusaders. Donal O'Brien. Martin Mooney tries a snapshot, and he equalises for Oma. Stephen Baxter trying to get away from his marker. Up goes O'Brien. And Burrows He makes it 2-1 for the Crows.
Aaron Callaghan has made his way up from the back. He's backpedaled all the way to the back post. Look out for number 5 for Crusaders, making the charge in. It was aimed towards Callaghan. Now here's Burrows.
A great effort by Sid Burrows. Oh, what a goal by the Crusaders.
Crusaders player of the year. He says this is the recognition he's been waiting for a very long time. Well, the new look league is back in swing today, and what a way to get things started. In the Premier Division, the Seasiders host Portadown, while Ards travel to Solitude. After their midweek European exploits, Glenavon face the might of Linfield at Mournview, while all eyes on the champions Crusaders, who are at home to the Glens.
What's gone's gone. Obviously, we can't go back and relive that one. But the bookmakers have us down, I think, as fourth favourites, and they're usually quite right about things. And for me, if we were to finish in the top four, in many ways, I'd be happy with that, because there's a lot of clubs that win league championships. I can think of Blackburn at presently, who are struggling the year after. Linfield won it the year before we did, and they finished eighth last year. So it's sometimes very difficult for the team that has just won it, where you've reached that emotional high, to go and do it all over again. But suffice to say, we'll be trying very hard to retain it. But we've got to be content with making sure we stay in the Premier Division. That's got to be the first aim.
Well won by Dunn. Hunter. It's fallen for Stephen Baxter. And it's 1-0 for Crusaders.
I think you set your standards, and we've certainly done that in the last two seasons. And as I say, it's probably the old cliche, everybody wants to beat the champions. But, you know, I know that whenever we play Linfields and Glentorns, that we want to beat them as well, so we won't look upon it that way. I think really the standard now, with the imports coming in from Scotland and from down south, has now evened everybody out a little bit. And so really.
Glen's on lock at the near post. Stephen Baxter is in there as well. Up goes Baxter. It's headed away by Devine though. Burrows keeps the ball in play. Hangs another tricky cross in. Dunlop, and he scored! Glen Dunlop scores with a free header for the Crews. 27 minutes gone in the first half, and Crusaders are in front. Callaghan. No one there. Parker and Devine over to sort things out. Devine's under some pressure. He's pulling around. Here's Glen Hunter. Well, that wasn't particularly sensible by the Glen Soren keeper. Sid Burrows wins the ball back superbly for Crusaders. McMullen's cross. Up goes Baxter. And it's 2-0. What a great goal by Stephen Baxter.
Oh, yes.
Back into Little, who turns McCartney. Now here's Cook, almost pulls one back for Glen Soren. It's off the bar and the danger's away. McAvoy drills one in, and McKeown makes an excellent save. Darren Finlay gets a cross in. Up goes Beattie, and now here's Cook. Now Little, who pulls one back for Glen Soren. Referee is looking at his watch, but Glen Soren still have time here to try and produce a dramatic equaliser. Cook, back to Michaels. Crews will be without keeper Kevin McKeown, who's playing for the Scottish B side in Sweden. Portadown travel to Glenavon the following evening. Now here's the action from all four quarter-finals played last night.
Crusaders dominated, but were caught on the break at Seaview with a superb volley from Philip Mitchell, which levelled the game at the interval. No further scoring. And on to the dreaded penalty shootout. Crews keeper Kevin McKeown scoring neatly. But Distillery's Aidan McAleenan, who'd often like to see the back of Kevin McKeown, didn't want it this way. And so it
with maximum points. We were at all four matches, and we start our roundup at Windsor Park.
He
Raymond Campbell has a swipe at Martin Murray. The referee is going to have a word with both players, I would think, here. Remember, Campbell and Murray have already been booked just a moment ago. The second yellow card, and it should be followed by a red one, I would think. Yes, indeed. Both players sent off, Murray and Campbell. Just about 10 seconds remaining in the first half. Linfield corner swung in by Stephen Beattie. Now here's Finlan. Finlan again, and it's 1-0 for Linfield. That's the second marvellous strike the little dynamo midfielder has hit in the space of a week. He struck against Glenavon last week, and he's done it again today.
3 minutes after the break, Crusaders were level, done with the corner, and Aaron Callaghan thundered in a strong header at the back post. But surely question marks there about the Linfield marking. The winner in this top of the table clash came on 61 minutes. Baxter is set free on the left. He sets in a dangerous cross, and Noel Bailey can only watch as his clearance ended up into the net. In the closing minutes, Darren Erskine had a chance, but Kevin McKeown celebrated his Scotland call-up with a super save from the striker.
Both teams were evenly matched in the first half, and it was an injustice that we did go down 1-0 down, go into the half, the break. But, fortunately...
And the Blues, with reserve keeper Andy Caldwell playing in the outfield, eventually beat Crusaders 3-2 after extra time. Ryan McCartney, that's into Burrows. Burrows gets a cross in.
Baxter has a strike, and Baxter has scored. 9.5 minutes gone in the first half, and Stephen Baxter swivels and shoots into the bottom corner. It's 1-0 for the Crews.
Exactly 20 minutes left in the first half. Stephen Baxter turns, and it's deceived the keeper, and it's over the line, and it is 2-0.
Baxter scores his second, and the fault, unfortunately, lies at the hands of the young Linfield keeper, Darren Crawford.
By Hosek, trying to pull one back here for Linfield, trotting off the ball. Hosek wins it back again, now it's to Gorman, a chance here for Linfield, if he can get a cross in, it's to the back post of Beattie,
and it's 2-1! What a tremendous goal by Stephen Beattie! Well, that's what you call a quick comeback. Within 30 seconds, the Blues make it 2-1.
Gorman tried to turn Dunlop, but Dunlop did superbly well. Linfield have the ball back again. Finlan. Now here's Bailey this time. Donald O'Brien and Pat Finlan having a little tussle.
And it's a red card for Donal O'Brien. Kirby Barr has sent them off. And a red for Pat Finlan too. And the referee is going to have some more words now after that challenge. Just the yellow one for Liam Dunn. Now Baxter's been brought down by Stuart McLean. It's going to be a booking for him too. Now Stephen Baxter keeps the ball in play for the Crews. Baxter's done very well indeed. It's in towards Hunter! And it's off the line by Judy Hill, I think. And a clash of heads there.
Let's hope this isn't as serious as it looks initially. Nice to see both players on their feet. Darren Crawford gets the game underway for Linfield, who, remember, have
the reserve group keeper Andy Caldwell on the pitch at the minute. He comes towering through there on Gary McCartney. Dorman keeps the ball in play. McElroy with the cross into the middle. And it's headed in, and it's through reach! Jackie Ozick has equalised for Linfield in injury time. I just don't believe it. Free kick for the Blues, taken by Stephen Beattie. Oh, they're up challenging, and it's 3-2. It's Stuart McLean. Deegan into Hunter. Now here's Glenn Dunlop. Good chance here for Dunlop. He's still going, Dunlop. Look for a penalty, and referee Herbie Barr has awarded it. Well, it's sensational stuff here tonight at the Oval. 7 minutes of extra time remaining. Trevor McMullen has this to square it for Crusaders. And he's missed it! McMullen has missed it! Seaview, the home of the champions. No local team had won there this season before Saturday. And when Glenn Hunter gave Crusaders the lead, the title holders were looking good. Although Glenavon soon had an opportunity to square things, Glenn Dunlop whisked the ball away from that potent poacher, Glenn Ferguson. And then the Crews' strike force almost combined for their second. Hunter's beautifully flighted cross and Baxter's header past O'Neill put off the woodwork. Raymond McCoy has spent the last few matches on the Lurgan Blues bench, but he started on Saturday and illustrated some wonderful skills to score the equaliser. The ball seemingly on a string. Ferguson's magnetic-like lob, one each. And Spike himself scored the winner to make it Glenavon's third successive league win at Seaview and the Crew's first domestic home defeat this season.
The chasing pack is led by Glenavon and Linfield. Distillery's win at Ballyclare keeps the Whites on top in the First Division, with closest rivals Coleraine and Ballymena losing ground.
First against second at Shamrock Park, and it was Portadown who took the lead after 8 minutes. A through ball by Peebles to that man Haylock, who scored from just inside the box for his 18th goal of the season. But like last week, it was Crusaders' late show. With a minute left, they launched one last attack. The ball was crossed by Mick Deegan, and when it wasn't cleared, sub Glenn Hunter was there for what could be a valuable equaliser.
Avon after beating the Lurgan Blues yesterday, and Crusaders moved into second thanks to victory over the league leaders. The battle lines amicably drawn between the two technical technicians from Portadown and Crusaders, and it looked most likely that the champions would strike the first blow, Glenn Hunter leading the line. But Portadown had come to prove that they can wrench the Gibson Cup from Seaview, and the Ports went one ahead with a goal from debutant midfielder Paul Carlisle since his transfer from Derry City. 10 minutes later, the Crews hit back. After good work by the impressive Donal O'Brien, Hunter pirouetted to level the scores. And Hunter was the engineer of Crusaders' second goal. Liam Dunn put him in the clear, and Hunter floated a magnetic-like cross onto the head of Stephen Baxter at the back post. Portadown manager Ronnie McFall admitted afterwards that his side defended badly, a rare poor display from his back four. Certainly Hunter tortured the Port's defence, who can thank keeper Tim Dalton for making some fine stops from the Crew striker. It was a typical, rugged, robust display of character-building football from the Crews, who based their success last season on a good Christmas run. Perhaps their win yesterday, after Hunter added the third, may be the springboard needed.
That makes up for all the games, isn't it? I was trying to get them in. But it's all about work rate. The rest of the boys were setting the balls on this, me and Big Stevie both. So we were taking our chances. And just makes us 1 point behind Portadown now. And if they want our title, we're going to have to work hard for it.
No goals at Windsor Park and the best incident.
Was apparent in a compelling defeat of leaders Portadown. Glenn Hunter on target twice. Stephen Baxter showing a welcome return to form. Glentoran are the visitors in one of the day's biggest games, and manager Tommy Cassidy will be looking for the.
Produce a great game, but plenty of incidents. Keeper Crawford does well here against Hunter. Crusaders press for long periods. This free kick by Murray and Hunter's hand of God wasn't appreciated by the referee. Referee Ross booked him, and that decision was correct. While the Blues had their moments, Crawford with Route 1 football. A great strike this by Richie Johnson, but it sailed over. Towards the end of the half, Crawford again rescued the Blues, pushing away Hunter's header from the cross by Burrows. The keeper was busy all afternoon. Hunter got on to the end of this ball, but Crawford collected. Referee Michael Ross had a fair game, but he got this one wrong. Erskine with the cross, and Dunlop clearly handled. The replay confirms it, and that will clearly anger the Blues. And what a cruel game it is. Last week, the goalkeeper of the month, but on Saturday, heartbreak for Darren Crawford. This shot from Murray, it slipped out of his hands and into the net. 3 points to the Crews.
Three goals scored in the first 8 minutes. Glenn Hunter made it 1-0. Keeper Willie Harkin did well to parry Stephen Baxter's shot, but Gary McCartney followed up. Glenn Hunter grabbed his second before half-time and then provided the cross for Stephen Baxter to seal the win.
4-2 to the Whites as they handed it a lesson to Lauren Tech. Alan Hall with the opening goal.
To give Crusaders the lead in the 68th minute. And on 73 minutes, Hunter was involved again as he set up Stuart Mellon, who put the ball past Beck to make it 2-0. It was the goal show of the Oval as Trevor Smith.
The storm did come on late in the game, and opinion remains divided as to whether the match should have been finished. But what is clear is that the result may not have stood. The question of abandoned games goes to the Irish League Emergency Committee. And in a case such as 1-0, it's likely the game would have to be replayed. That could happen with Distillery Carrick. Here's Irish League President Martin McKnight.
After our game on Saturday, it went to 75 minutes. You're playing for such high stakes, some people could well be feel a wee bit disappointed.
Severe lack of orange balls once again as well. That's a brief taste of the sport for now, but coming up at the usual time of about 6:40, the latest row in local soccer. Crews midfielder Martin Murray says he's innocent, but Glenavon manager Nigel Bell. Murray challenging for a bouncing ball. The clash leaving Doherty in some distress. Doherty claims Murray's elbow was deliberate. Murray says it was accidental. Make up your own minds. But today we ask Glenavon manager Nigel Best to view the incident and give his reaction.
It would appear that Martin Murray deliberately elbowed Lee Doherty in the ribs. What worries me is that, and it is a physical contact game, and I understand people's attitudes that you're grown men, you play in it. But there are certain types of incidents in matches which will cause somebody a serious injury. And our understanding from the hospital is that Doherty could have had a lung punctured with that, and that worries me.
Speaking to Martin Murray today, he said he's absolutely disgusted with the whole thing and that Glenavon are actually starting a witch hunt against him. What's your reaction to that?
Well, before I came down here, I saw some comments in one of the papers today from Martin, and the first thing is, if Martin had have looked at the newspapers all over the weekend, I have not made any attempt to use that incident as an excuse for us losing the match, and he would have been better to check that out.
And Crusaders manager Roy Walker was unavailable today. Well, Portadown were knocked off the top of the Irish League Premier Division 1 on Saturday. The Ports lost to Ards, while the Crews went top after defeating Glenavon. Champions cruise to the top of the table after Saturday's 1-0 defeat of Glenavon for the first time this season. And they kept Glenavon keeper Dermot O'Neill pretty busy in the process. Stephen Baxter and then Donal O'Brien with testing efforts. This was Crusaders' fourth consecutive win without conceding a goal and their ninth win in 10 matches. Liam Dunn hit the winner midway through the second half. And as the game turned to farce, he reflected on his first goal this season.
I think it's a long overdue, you know.
Made to where the league championship title may just end up. After this game, though, we're really none the wiser. Crusaders outplayed, outthought and outmanoeuvred Portadown, but couldn't shut them out. Martin Murray's tremendous finish gave Crusaders the lead. And as the Reds' defence struggled, Glenn Hunter had a fine opportunity to make it 2-0 in the second half. Then came the twist. On-loan strikers have a habit of scoring important goals for Portadown, and Luton Town's Jamie Woodsford did just that with 5 minutes to go. And Gary...
thanks to an inspired performance from reserve team goalkeeper Damien Grant. His crucial extra-time save from Mark Anderson took the game into penalties and spared Crusaders blushes at going out on golden goals to a First Division side. Grant's first team opportunities have been limited at Seaview, but he didn't let his teammates down as he pulled off two saves in the shootout, denying both Tommy McElroy and Gary Walker. The second save in sudden death left Glenn Hunt joined third our Crusaders after a one-all draw with Glentoran at the Oval. More ugly scenes as well after John Devine's challenge on goalkeeper Kevin McKeown. Devine put his boot to better use with the Glens opener, a lead they held until late in the second half, when substitute Chris Morgan secured a share of the points for Crusaders.
Crusaders moved up into second place after beating the reigning champions 2-0, and Portadown have only secured 4 points out of the last 24.
Crusaders have emerged as Coleraine's closest challengers with very little fuss or commotion. While Portadown, without a win in 8 league games, were lacklustre and defensive, Crusaders attacked from the start. McKeown made a good save from this Paul Dwyer volley. 5 minutes before the break, Sid Burrows got in behind the Portadown defence, but was bundled off the ball by Major. Referee Frank McDonald was unimpressed, but it does look like Crusaders should have had a penalty. The visitors kept pushing forward, and Donal O'Brien just failed to thread this volley through the Portadown defence. 0-0 at half-time, but Crusaders went in front midway through the second half. Glenn Hunter with the deft finish past Keenan. A classic Crusaders goal this, Baxter with the flick on, and Hunter coolly got goal side of his marker. Portadown looked for a way back into the game, but McKeown and McMullen combined here to clear the danger. Four minutes from time, Crusaders sewed up the points. Baxter the provider again, and Hunter ran onto the pass for his second of the game.
Puno win at Portadown, and the ailing champions fortunate not to concede a first half penalty when Philip Major appeared to push Sid Burrows. In the end, it didn't matter. On 65 minutes, Stephen Baxter headed down, and Glenn Hunter unmarked as he nipped in to score. 4 minutes from time, that partnership worked again. Baxter's through ball, and the defence had gone missing as Hunter picked his spot. 2-0 Crusaders. Glenavon missed the chance to go second after a 0-0 draw at Cliftonville. Shane Mulholland almost won it for Glenavon, but Paul Rice did well.
Stevie Baxter went on a marauding run to set up Glenn Hunter for his 16th of the season. Arge new boy Martin Pemberton proved a handful for the Crusaders' defence, his positive contribution underscored with a ball under McKeown. And both sides were reduced to 10 men for what appeared to be an exchange of spittle. That intimate moment promptly ending the game for Harry McCourt and Martin Murray.
The top of the table. Crusaders replaced Coleraine thanks to a 2-0 win at local rivals Cliftonville. 36-year-old Gary McCartney put them on their way with the opener after 15 minutes. And the points were sealed just after the break, when Glenn Hunter bagged his 19th goal of the season. The Crews go top, the Reds stay rooted to the bottom. A seventh successive Premier League draw means Coleraine are now second. A first win since November the 23rd seemed possible.
O'Brien. It's gone in! Quite incredibly, Donal O'Brien has given Crusaders the lead. Well, they've been handing out free crisps here today at Seaview, and most of them are now in Kevin McKeown's goal mouth. I hope he likes cheese and onion. And Rory Hamill is onside. Hamill. That's a super finish by Rory Hamill. It's 1-1 at Seaview.
Linfield's home form is nothing short of dismal.
Broke the deadlock. But the striker's joy was tempered somewhat when he was booked for his over-enthusiastic celebrations. 4 minutes later, the battling Crews were back, a sweeping move, and Glenn Hunter slipped in to put the game into extra time. It looked a case of penalties all over before super sub Brian Russell had a glancing header with 3 minutes to go. Rough justice on the Blues, the Crews march on.
Glenavon found their feet.
Stephen Baxter put Crusaders 1-1 6 minutes in, before an own goal from Gary McCartney tied things up on 18.
Was quick and incisive. Barry O'Connor survived appeals for offside to put them in front on 3 minutes. On 26 minutes it was 2 for O'Connor and Cliftonville. McCann's corner wasn't cleared and the striker hooked the ball past McKeown. Burrow's terrific pass put Glenn Hunter in before half-time and Crusaders were back in the game. But they couldn't find a way through in the second half and Paul...
Tonight they beat Ards 5-1 to leapfrog over Coleraine, who lost to Glentoran by 1-0. Glenavon beat Linfield 3-1, Glenn Ferguson scored twice, bottom of the table Cliftonville drew 0 each with Portadown. Glentoran moved into fourth place in the league tonight. James Quigley scored the winner in the first half at the Oval, but a very disappointing performance by Coleraine. Splendid display though by Crusaders at Castlereagh Park. Trailing 1-0, they scored 5 goals in the second half, 3 in the space of 6 minutes. Glenn Hunter netted twice. Donal O'Brien also scored a brace, Chris Morgan with the other. Ards conceding 5 goals for the second consecutive game. So Crusaders top, 2 points clear of Coleraine. Glenavon third, 7 points further adrift. It's a two-horse race with 4 games left. Remember, Crusaders and Coleraine still have to meet at Seaview. Results in the first division, Ballyclare 0, Bangor 2. The Seasiders now in outright. ...is left against Glenavon, Portadown and Linfield. The other is away to Crusaders, and it could well be the decider. Go! Crusaders are now favourites for the title after beating Ards 5-1 to jump 2 points ahead of Coleraine. And even though Ards took the lead through Paul Powell, Roy Coyle's side conceded 5 goals for the second consecutive game. Stephen Baxter is the league's leading goal scorer this season, but he left the job to his striking partner last night. Straight from the heart, Glenn Hunter scored a brace in the space of 3 minutes. Still over half an hour left, Crusaders were 2-1 in front. And just 2 minutes and 2 rebounds later, Donal O'Brien added a third. And he enjoyed it. After 86 minutes, O'Brien scored his second. Chris Morgan completed the scoring before full time, but still no title talk from Crusaders, and rightly so.
They still have Glentoran, Coleraine, Cliftonville and Portadown all to play. That's good. Crews will be champions for the second time in 3 years. Crusaders have opted for a vow of silence in the build-up to the match, but Coleraine are singing like birds on a short time.
We're going live to Derry in a few minutes to talk to their victorious manager, Felix Healy. But first here in Belfast, we're joined by Roy Walker. The league trophy safely back at Seaview for the second time in 3 years. First of all, congratulations. It's all about timing. It's a marathon race. Your timing was perfect.
Well, it was using the analogy of American football, where you can be behind for three quarters, but it matters not what you do then, it's what you do in the final quarter. And we came through with a gallop at the end, and that was good enough.
Your second championship in 3 years, how does this compare, Roy?
Well, arguably it's a harder league to win. When we got, we were like 15 points clear, and the posse couldn't catch up. But this time it was more fraught and tense, and we had to come from behind and make up a deficit of some 11 points. So you don't get no respite in this league at the moment, so this is a sweet one also.
And of course we can see the pictures, great celebrations there at the weekend. It means so much to the club.
It means so much to the area. I think it's not an area of great affluence, and the people in it, I think I know most of them personally now over the years, and they're wonderful people. And the support we had on Saturday, and indeed all season, has been just out of the top drawer.
Now, you've had two championships in 3 years, but you've also known the heartbreak of losing championships right at the death. A word for Coleraine.
Well, we've been there twice. We've lost it twice, very close, and times when people fancied us to win it. So I can sympathise completely with them. I mean, I think the first thing I did on Saturday was console some of their players before I seen my own players. But what it did for us was galvanised us into an even stronger unit, and if it does the same for them, then they'll be a force to be reckoned with.
And back into Europe again, you must be delighted about that.
Well, let's hope we get a good draw.
Afternoon belonged to Crusaders and their fans. With so much at stake, too much tension destroyed the game as a spectacle. Clear-cut chances were few and far between. Coleraine knew they had to win the game to keep alive their chances and deny the Crews. 16 minutes from time, they almost did. A header.
Cesarevic, Crusaders' hot shot is staying at Seaview. After weeks of being linked with the transfer to Ballymena, the 29-year-old has finally agreed a new deal with the Irish League champions. Hunter scored for the Crews against Ballymena on Saturday, and that's where we begin our roundup.
Glenn Hunter provided a double dose of disappointment for Ballymena on Saturday. First, he agreed a new contract with the Crews. Then he rubbed United's noses in it by opening the scoring in a 4-2 win at Seaview. It was Hunter's 140th goal for Crusaders, nine short of Curry Mulholland's all-time club record. Ominously for the rest, the champions are looking as good as ever, and after 2 weeks are where they finished last year's campaign, top of the table. Gavin Arthur and Footballer of the Year Stephen Baxter were both on target again at the weekend as the home side swept into a 3-0 lead. They did have a fright though as Ballymena finally showed some of the form that had taken them to last season's First Division title. Declan McCreevy and Ian Muir cutting the deficit. But as United pushed forward for an unlikely point, they were caught short at the back. Donal O'Brien with the sucker punch, 3 points for the Crews. Coleraine began last season's league campaign with 7 wins.
To flick home. But the Reds continued to work hard. They were awarded with a Jody Tolan goal. The ball eventually back from the byline, and a good finish this from a striker. He certainly enjoyed the goal and his celebrations. Into the second half, the defending champions continued to press, the ball not cleared. In the end, a clever ball in from Mick Deegan and Glenn Hunter with the goal. Well, Crusaders on their way to 3 points, or so it seemed, but then a simple ball in and a real clanger, this from keeper Damien Grant. Crusaders left fuming, delight for the home side, and 2-2 in the end. And also called off on Saturday is the Carradore 100 and a Rugby Ulster's opening Heineken Cup match with Glasgow.
He's the Crew. Spectacular overhead kick. Glenn Hunter made it 2-0, but Gavin Arthur stole the show with two super efforts in the 79th and 80th minutes, taking his tally of goals for the season to 8.
And finally, the Ulster Cup results tonight. Ballyclare 4, Larne 0.
Crusaders first against Ballyclare after just 82 seconds. Rooney's strength and persistence were then rewarded with Ballyclare's equaliser midway through the first half. After the game, Ballyclare boss Alan Campbell was critical of his goalkeeper Damian McCusker. Chris Morgan poked in Crusaders second, and Ian Young then provided evidence that Crusaders have plenty of talent in reserve as he got their third.
Joining Crusaders at the top of Group A on Max to put the Crews ahead against Linfield. There was no way back for the Blues after that. Glenavon joined Crusaders and Portadown on 11 points.
Stephen Baxter's superb control and vision put Glenn Hunter in for Crusaders first at St Julian's Road. But Oma have made themselves
Hunter to glance a ball past Scullion. Glenavon levelled the scores after Mark Glendinning was bundled over. Man of the match, Stephen Caffrey, made no mistake from the spot. Roy Walker's half-time team talk meant the Crews were a different side throughout the second period, but although the managers to the players, it resulted in him being ordered off by referee Herbie Barr.
Box, whether it's at work during the week or at 149 goals in two separate spells of Crusaders has seen him equal the club's all-time scoring record. One more tomorrow against Portadown, and Glenn Hunter will write his name into the history books, replacing Curry Mulholland, a star round Seaview in the 1950s.
No, I actually know nothing about him. I've seen his photograph on Aaron Saturday night one week, but I haven't been fortunate enough to meet him. And his record's lasted 40 years, and It's been one to beat, so hopefully I can get one to last for that length of time.
As many an Irish League defender will tell you, Hunter has been one of the best in the business for many years now. He scored goals in all the local competitions, but it's one in Europe that stands out as his personal favourite.
My goal in UEFA Cup against Silkeborg, I think it was two seasons ago, well, it stands out because it's my first goal in Europe, and I think Crusaders' first goal in Europe in 27 years. So it was special in two ways. I remember Aaron playing a long ball in. And the first touch was very good at the time, and I just volleyed it with my left foot. So, and their keeper didn't see it till it came out again.
One more like that tomorrow and Hunter can breathe easy. His place in Crusaders folklore assured.
Well, Glentoran today signed a new striker on loan. He's Michael Midwood from Huddersfield Town. The Glens' double goal scorer last Saturday against the Crews is a slight injury worry for tomorrow's visit to Coleraine. Darren Parker has an ankle knock. But it'll take a lot more than that to keep the Ballymena student out of action for two.
The 50th for the club, but his celebrations were short-lived. Portadown won 3-1.
Unlike Ian Wright earlier this season, Glenn Hunter ended the speculation about his scoring record by getting the all-important goal first time out and airing his specially prepared 150 t-shirt to the fans.
Roy had a chat with me before, just let it happen, you know, I mean, don't go out and push, because when you start putting pressure on yourself, you know, I mean, you don't do the things that you need to do. So I wasn't really thinking about it, you know, when it happened I was glad, because the chance just actually fell to me. You know, big Stevie had his shin and come back to me, but you know, I was glad it happened early, but it took a bit of pressure off.
But the afternoon took a downturn for Hunter and Crusaders after that, and included a missed second-half penalty.
I was feeling confident when I was stepping up to take the penalty. I never even looked at the keeper in the way they're allowed to dance about the line now, but I felt confident, I knew where I was putting it. Unfortunately, I hit the smallest thing in front of me. You know, it was disappointing.
Portadown's twin strike force of Arkins and Haylock punished Crusaders' wastefulness with three lessons in the art of goal scoring. Their strikes were the obvious difference between two evenly matched sides, and Glenn Hunter knows the value of a clinical finisher to a team with its eye on the title.
When you've got strengths like that there up front, and both have the ability to score goals, you know, I mean, the chances to go in for them. they put the pressure on us straight away after we missed the penalty, and they took their chances, which again knocked the heart out of us. But we tried to put pressure on them, but it just didn't happen, wasn't to be.
Well, last year's First Division champions, Ballymena, are top of the Premier League after beating Cliftonville 2-0. There's action from that along with Coleraine and
Patton entertained the fans and kept the Crusaders defenders on their toes as he scored his 13th goal of the season for a first half lead. Last week, Crusaders striker Glenn Hunter broke the long-standing club record. He scored two more in 8 minutes on Saturday, this one to give Crusaders a 2-1 lead. His best goal ever, probably. And just 1 minute later, another goalkeeping classic, this time from Darren Crawford. And quick thinking, which resulted in Chris Morgan's goal, gave the champions the points. OMA secured their first ever senior league win against Linfield. It was OMA's second Premier success of the season.
The lead over Crusaders. Fortunately for Cruz, Glenn Hunter took centre stage, his first from a tight angle. His second had a searching for superlatives. One touch to control, the second touch sent it flying into the net. A goal for Hunter to remember. Will we see a better one this season? Hunter then laid on a third for Chris Morgan, and despite Ian Buster's penalty, the Crews got the 3 points. So Cliftonville back on top, but just 3 points separate the top five there. Linfield and Glentoran both are in the bottom half. In the League of Ireland, champions Derry City hit five in Kilkenny, 4 goals from up.
The Reds' defence failed to clear Baxter's cross, and Gavin Arthur capitalised. But 2 goals in the space of 5 minutes early in the second half saw Cliftonville go in front. Both from Jody Tolan, the first after good work by Marty McCann. The same player involved in the build-up for the second. And Tolan again obliged with the finish. The Crusaders' equaliser, a vintage strike from Alan Dornan. What a finish from the former Linfield captain.
Desi Gorman tied things up 2 minutes later, though, before Gavin Arthur put the league champions ahead once again. That's the way it stayed until the 89th minute. Gorman with his and Newry's second goal of the game to take the match into sudden death. And it was the home...
Peter Murray.
The 7-goal show started early at Seaview, with Peter Murray opening the scoring in just 2 minutes. But Crusaders steadied the ship, drawing level through Glenn Hunter, and then taking the lead courtesy of Stephen Baxter. Even at that stage, though, Ballymena heads didn't go down.
Well, as we said, at half-time, we were 2-1 down. The manager says, look, just keep playing away, and he says it will come to you, and fair play to the manager. 5 minutes ago, it was 3-8, so a lot of teams at CV would have just settled for the draw, but he threw on Lee Kalnish, and... he'd done the business.
Two plus points about Saturday's performance were the character the team showed and the fact that the goals are now coming from all over the field.
It was absolutely a fantastic game. You know, the thing that pleased me most was not only the way come back twice to beat Crusaders, but to out-battle them and out-fight Crusaders. That series was a no mean feat. Barry Patton has been excellent for us this season, but I think if you look at Philip Nail and myself, Dr. McGreevy, we're all scoring from midfield, which is very important.
With things getting congested at the top of the Premier Division and with the crucial Christmas campaign ahead.
Revival continued on Saturday. Alan Dornan, a defender who likes to go forward, again playing his part, before Gavin Arthur flashed the ball home for the opener for the champions. A miserable afternoon brightened by Glenn Hunter's 19th of the season. In truth, he knew little about it. As conditions worsened, a touch of class from Stephen Baxter, his thumping shot smacked off the crossbar. With 13 minutes to go, Crusaders wrapped up the 3 points, Gavin Arthur winning the chase to the ball before the keeper to slide the ball home.
...request was finally granted by the Mournview board. And Glenn Hunter will play his first game for Ballymena United after his move from Crusaders. Hunter is likely to be on the bench for the match at OMA Town.
The sky blues the limit for Ballymena's new record signing.
£20,000 is a big investment in the Irish League these days, proof that last season's First Division champions are deadly serious in their bid for this year's Premier Division crown. Glenn Hunter's goals helped Crusaders to the title last year. He's aiming for a second successive championship medal.
Ballymena have a good chance, and well, hopefully I'll strengthen their strike force alongside Barry Patton, so who knows.
It is a big challenge for you because they've been scoring plenty of goals. I mean, it'll be a challenge straight away to force your way into the team, won't it?
Well, yes, well, as far as I know, Barry scored 20, well, I scored 19, so we're on a par. You know, I mean, it's, I've nothing to prove to Alan Fraser. He knows what I can do. He was at Linfield when I was there, and it's just really up to me to prove to the Ballymena supporters what I can do and win them over.
Five of those 19 goals this season have come against Ballymena. United boss Alan Fraser has always been a fan of Hunter. He tried to sign him at the start of the season. Now he's finally got his man.
Well, Glenn's a good player. He's a quality player and he's a goal scorer. And I think every team, you know, no matter how many goals you're scoring, you're always on the lookout for quality players. And certainly Glenn comes into that category. But, you know, it's important that it's a three-year contract, he's saying, and I don't want people to think Glenn's going to come in and just take off right away. It'll take him time to settle, and this is why he's in a three-year contract.
Hunter is not the only top striker on the move. Glenn Ferguson will play his last game for Glenavon tomorrow.
Some more problems there for Marty Quinn. Carrick 2, Coleraine 2 and Distillery 1, Bangor 1. So Ballymena go top. Section B was a closer affair. The results there.
While the Glens only sneaked a draw with Ballymena. And that's where we start our comprehensive roundup.
After their great escape last week against Coleraine, there was another Houdini act from the Glens on Saturday. Pete Beattie's miscued clearance came off the woodwork, and Glenn Hunter put Ballymena ahead with his sixth goal of the season. But Beattie made amends in second-half stoppage time when his cross was eventually converted by David Rennie for the equaliser.
Hold on for so long and then blow it in injury time, you know. It's the way things have been going for us. We haven't been able to kill teams off, and, well, you get your just deserves.
Yuri Tarn took a first-half lead against Coleraine. John Kenny's cross, 100th game in charge. Crusaders stayed fourth with a 3-2 win at Cliftonville. Gavin Arthur grabbed two in his last game for the Crews. At 2-2, a diving header from Connor Frawley sealed the points for the men from Seaview. Ballymena were one up at Portadown when Des Lockery's swerving right-footer meant more misery for Ronnie McFall's team. A very neat effort from Keith Percy gave United their third. 3-1 the final score, United fifth.
The motion reveals that referee Alan Snoddy really had little option, and Chisholm was shown the red card for the early bath. The winner for Coleraine, well, it really was a beautiful set-up goal. Shane McQuillan out here on the left.
To down when Isaac Ingley supplied a classic striker's header. 3 minutes later, it was level. Raymond Byrne spotted keeper Wes Lamont in no-man's land. The lob did the rest. Just after half-time, Portadown made sure of a semi-final spot. Vinnie Arkin's run and side-foot finish made it 2-1. The Ports wait on the winners of the Ballymena Distillery replay. On Saturday, a fumble let Glenn Hunter in to give United the lead. A corner gave the Whites a second-half equaliser. The diminutive Damien Kelly jumped highest to flick in the header.
Both replays at Ballymena and more.
And in the second half, a simple move restored Ballymena's lead. Nail the provider this time, and Keith Percy, coolness personified. Well, Ballymena protested loudly about this late penalty award, but referee Leslie Irvine had no hesitation in awarding the spot kick to Vinnie Arkins.
Distillery, Michael Crowe's late equaliser left home boss Nigel Best fuming.
Too late for the champions. You boys, Lisburn Distillery, were one down at Ballymena when Michael Crowe hammered in a late equaliser, the Whites unbeaten after two games. Portadown were trailing
First half goals at New Grosvenor, but a 7-goal spree in the second between Lisburn Distillery and Ballymena United in this battle of the bottom. The home side reduced to 10 men with Paul Prenter deliberately handled the ball from this effort. The player off and Hunter made no mistake with the kick. But hesitancy from Dermot O'Neill allowed Jim McCluskey to use his height and nip in to level the score. And Ballymena built up a 2-goal cushion thanks to a Hunter well-placed header. And then followed a spectacular 30-yard strike here from John Gregg. Good control, brilliant finish. O'Neill's handling causing more concern when he spilled a shot from Chris Deegan and Darren Armour bundled home the rebound. Hunter was the real thorn in the side for this Distillery team. He made it 4-2 after neat work out there on the left. Although there was still time for substitute Jamie Clappin to place a header past O'Neill. But the points to Ballymena.
A good win for Ballymena and a hat-trick for yourselves. That's about the goals.
First one was a penalty. Actually, Racer was up with us for a while there. My practice penalties against him, so I wasn't sure where to put it. But I was glad to see it going in. The second one, a great cross by Barry, who's just back. So all credit to him, he made a good run and good cross in. And the third one, really, I just went for it. I knew it was on a hat-trick. And I hit it from an acute angle there, so I'm very pleased. But the points were far more important than that.
A strange game. It's things when you're down, everything goes against you, you know. And I thought we did reasonably well. Both teams sort of battled it out in the first half. Second half, we come out and give a silly goal away. And which is par for the course for us at the moment. And then we got ourselves back in the game, only to go and throw it away again. But it's difficult when you're down to 10 men, you know. Young lad showed us an experience. He div with a hand and pushed it around the post, and we're down to 10 men. I mean, if it let it go in, you're 1-0 down, but at least you've still your 11 players in the park to work with. But I thought we showed a lot of character, a lot of battle in the second half.
0-0 at half time, I couldn't imagine 7 goals in the second half.
No, well, the second half was entertaining, maybe a little bit too entertaining for my liking in the dugout when we're 2 or 3 goals and up, we should be staying that way. But the credit to both sets of players, it became an open match. Even in the first half, both sides had a couple of chances, and it could easily have been one each or two each at half time. It was a good open game, and it was an entertaining game in my opinion.
You went to bed. Vinnie Arkins made the score sheet after McComb fouled Hill. 4-0 to Portadown.
After last week's comprehensive victory at the Oval, Newry picked up where they left off. John McDonald with the opener after just 4 minutes from Raymond Campbell's corner. And Campbell went one better, this hopeful cross deceiving everyone to give Newry a 2-0 advantage at half time. Dermot O'Neill denied Kieran Fain from the penalty spot at the start of the second period. It proved to be a turning point, for Ballymena hit back from the head of Philip Nell shortly afterwards. And the prospect of Ballymena's 11th draw was a distinct possibility. So it proved, for substitute Glenn Hunter, level matters in the final 10 minutes, turning sharply to claim a share of the spoils.
Staying with soccer,
Derek. Here the seventh successively 2-0 with goals by John McDonald and Ray Campbell. But Ballymena pulled back to earn their 11th draw of the league campaign with goals by Philip Nell and sub Glenn Hunter.
43 overs today, but just when South Africa looked in difficulty, Daryl Cullinan scored another century to help his side reach 421 in reply to England's 258. The Spice Girl Mel G and her husband Jimmy Gulzar are on opposite sides of the world this evening after reports that their marriage has collapsed. She's gone to Thailand with their baby daughter. He's at the couple's home in Buckinghamshire. Juliet Bremner looks at what may have gone wrong in their 16-month marriage.
I should let my players when they...
Glenavon's title impetus took another hammering at Ballymena yesterday. Prior to the match, United had just 2 league wins from 22 attempts. But they scored on the first real attack when keeper Philip Matthews' initial save fell to Andrew Swalwell, who hit it back with interest. And Ballymena went further ahead when Mark Carlisle's free kick found Hunter via Nail, United's leading goalscorer making no mistake. Nigel Best's side must have been expecting Glenavon to hit back with a brace for the home side's compulsory draw, but they never came. And so Glenavon looked like fighting for second place, while the points eased Ballymena's relegation fears.
Already,
with another 13 games to go.
And is that a record you want or not?
I don't think so. I mean, at the end of the season, if you're sack based and that, nobody's going to remember it too well. So it's not a record you want. You want a record which shows that the team has performed well and isn't relegated. And unfortunately, draws only get you 1 point. And that leaves us in the lower end of the league, which is not very comfortable. And our intention is now to start winning matches to pull ourselves up from that. But having said that, I'll still emphasise we are a difficult team to beat.
Many of United's 13 draws have come about thanks to last-minute equalisers. It's been quite a season in charge for Nigel Best, so has he enjoyed it?
Do you see what I look like today? You tell me that I'm enjoying it. I'm grey, bald, bags under my eyes. On a Saturday afternoon, I can hardly eat after the match, and I think my players are trying to kill me, and that's what I honestly believe sometimes. So I know for a lot of managers, there is an enjoyment in managing football, but I'm not convinced that for 90 minutes on a Saturday afternoon they get full fulfilment in life.
They're in the last four games, but more importantly, it's their 18th league win of the season. With games running up. It was second from top against second from bottom at the Oval when Glentoran met Ballymena, and the home side threatened to overrun their opponents when Stuart Elliott hit past Paul Callaghan for the opening goal in the opening minutes. But Ballymena's Glenn Hunter left it level at the interval. The striker has now scored in six of United's last seven Premiership games, and he added his 12th league goal, assisted to a large degree by keeper Alan Gough. But the Braid men were again punished for a slow start at the beginning of the second period. Midfielder Scott Young collecting Gilzean's pass before putting the Glens ahead for a second time. Ballymena seemed to play best when facing defeat, and the side with double the average number of draws looked like sharing the points again when Glenn Hunter hit a great shot from the edge of the box to make it 2-2. However, the game was decided in controversial fashion when Scott Young scored after referee David Malcolm awarded a penalty for the Glens.
Well, if that's a penalty kick, we may give up football and referees may stop being involved in football. It has to be a deliberate hand to ball, a deliberate intentional handball, and the fella is standing with two hands by his side and the ball's flicked from 2 foot into his hand. He makes no attempt to play the ball and the referee couldn't give the
back twice against Crusaders at Seaview to claim a vital point, first falling behind to Darren Lockhart's chip and Peter Murray's header. However, it was all square at half-time as Glenn Hunter connected with Jerry Flynn's free kick for the first of a brace. The Crews took the initiative again after the interval and were on course for only their second win in seven games when Ballymena failed to clear effectively and Paul Muir scored his first goal for the club from all of 30 yards. The visitors, with only 3 wins from 28 games, set a new Premiership record of 15 draws when Hunter completed the scoring at 2-2, his 16th league goal of the season. A crucial point that keeps Ballymena one above Distillery.
Well, I thought it was a tough game. Both teams battled well. You know, we both had chances, but I say we got a point again, but you know, we were looking for 3 points. This time of season, not too many games left. We need the 3 points.
I can't really say too much about the performance. I think we had probably 3 or 4 people a little off colour today, didn't play, and we struggled for long periods, but as I said, I'm happy with a point.
I can't but say
3 points clear at the top of the table with just 5 games remaining.
Need a great comeback and signal emotional scenes for Linfield and their fans.
Pick themselves up for Saturday's vital league clash with Glentoran, which has a place in Europe at stake.
And what about Glentoran themselves? Well, they travelled to bottom of the table Ballymena last night, hoping to take another step towards the runners-up spot in the league and a place in the UEFA Cup. But it didn't work out like that.
The most controversial moment of this match came right at the end. Before that, Ballymena had shocked the Glens by racing into a 2-goal lead. Philip Nell headed the first, and Glenn Hunter fired in the second 5 minutes later. But Glentoran bounced back in the second half. Stuart Elliott gave them some encouragement with a goal after 56 minutes. The East Enders continued to dominate after that, but couldn't